I might be the only one. Hello. That was brilliant.
That was brilliant. That was made by Tim Coleman. So thank you, Tim.
Tim Coleman was absolutely brilliant. Now you are condemned to do that every episode.
I want that every episode, Tim. Every I want episode, it on my desk. I want pictures of Spider-Man.
That was brilliant.
Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's the end of the show. And yeah,
see you next week.
We'll do 2 hours of end credits now.
Paul, everyone's noticing your background slightly different. Slightly different.
Slightly different. Yes, I've moved into my Roald Dahl comfy chair.
Oh
yes. This is where I sit with 24-hour rolling news, just going Trump, Trump, Trumpity Trump. Time for
like,
you.
Like the bloody nerd, the elephant, joined that circus.
Well, yes. Now you went all weird then, John. You're back now. You're fine.
I didn't get this end.
Oh, you went weird my end. You went like Max Headroom. You went in the elephant.
Okay.
Which was possibly the best thing you've ever done.
Well, I wish I could repeat it.
Oh, I want you to. So, yeah, I've just been watching 25 Rolling News in my chair. Just going, just come on. I want him to, I really want to see him literally naked on the roof with a shotgun, trying to take out drones. And because there's no way that man's going to leave ever.
No, apparently I am going funny and I've got low bandwidth. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go out and come back in.
Yeah, I think you should.
I'll be right back.
Well, whilst John's away, you can have a perusal at my lovely TARDIS, which is there. Isn't it lovely? And inside it's full of pegs, which you don't really need to know about. And I've got some gladioli just over there, which I thought would brighten up the room. And that's why John's an absolute... Oh,
you didn't.
Oh, you rotter.
You didn't tell him a secret, did you?
I did. Oh, you fool. So how's been your week, Jonathan of Rain?
It's been all right. It's been tiring because I've basically been since... When did the election start? 1984.
Year of our Lord.
Whatever day the election started, I cannot remember now. I have been basically going to bed every night at about 2 a.m. because I've been foolishly staying up to see if something would happen.
Yes, and foolishly nothing has happened.
Yeah, no, nothing's happened. And but although the end result is that I'm very fucking tired.
Right. And you're now in lockdown. Are you going to work or are you furloughed now?
I'm slightly furloughed.
It's just the way you walk. you're slightly furloughed.
Slightly furloughed. So I'm down one day. So I'm only doing 2 days a week at work. So it gives me three days off to do some lovely writing, get that book finished.
Right. Yes, of course. Yes, you've got that to do. And your 78 podcasts. So
and my 78 podcasts. Although next week I'm having a week off. I should say up front now.
Yeah, he's having the entire week off, everyone.
There'll be no JP special next week.
No.
No.
I know he needs a rest.
I do need a rest. I'm like a snooker player with short arms.
He's having a rest. He's not even going to 6 out of his 9 regular prostitutes.
No, well, 2 of them got furloughed.
Right. Yeah. And the other 3 are on casters and in plaster. So
caster plaster.
Caster plaster.
Yeah. So there we go. There's a bit of admin at the front there.
Oh. That's true.
Yeah.
So shall we look at comments and then dive straight into our first section?
Let's look at comments. Ben Thomas says, no GP special next week, lazy pricks.
Right, yes. Well, that's an opinion worth saying.
Hurtful. Tim Coleman says, Jeffrey Palmer, who died today? And he did.
He died today.
And I was very sad about it. Although he's 93, he was always very nice. He was always very nice to see him on things.
93 years young.
Yeah, who died today.
They didn't say of what he died of what.
He was, I actually read this. It's actually quite a sad story.
Oh, no, it's not right.
He's in a motorcycle display team.
Right, right.
And he was at the front with everyone on his shoulder.
Right.
And he got distracted by a beautiful butterfly.
Right.
Which is very rare this time of year. They're usually not around.
Yes, yes.
And he ended up going under a low-hanging bridge.
Right.
And everybody, got toppled on top of him.
Yes.
And he drove off a cliff. He was fine. And then he went home. And he died of natural causes when he got home.
Okay. Good Lord.
Yeah. I shouldn't have bothered talking about the motorcycle display team stuff. But
well, no. It's nice to know that he did have a hobby.
It's context, I think.
Yes, absolutely. So
hopefully, with the power of technology, we can summon him one week, like we did with your dear friend Graham.
Yeah, maybe. Yeah, or maybe we should just best leave alone.
Yeah.
Any more comments before we crack on?
Didn't Jeffrey Palmer brown sugar and mustard his own face and cook himself to death? No, he didn't. Ebb, whoever you are.
Ebb? Or should we say lowest ebb?
Of course, Sean, who died last week. Yeah.
Yes. And then the week before was Bobby Ball. So they're all coming down like dominoes.
I was quite sad about Bobby Ball, I have to say.
I was more sad about Jeffrey Palmer, to be honest.
No, that's true. But I was still sad about Bobby.
How sad? Oh,
Bobby.
Out of 10. 9.
So no, then.
Oh, right. Okay.
No more fucking Graham.
Well, no, that's not that. We haven't said that. Look,
I miss Graham. See, Simon misses Graham.
Well, you never know. He might be back.
He was very popular.
He might be back next week when we're not on air.
Palmer was wonderful. Bit of a cock up on the breathing front. His last line on arriving in heaven.
Of course, yes. Yeah,
that would make a very good cartoon in a paper.
Yeah, I was doing some jokes to some friends of mine today that obviously you can never put online because they're just along that vein. Just jokes about him dying, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah. I'm a coroner and I want my sausages. And we just thought, we can't go down that route. Yeah.
Although if he was eaten by a cannibal, the cannibal could say that.
That's true. My favorite, which I came up with, was horse-drawn hearse technique, as they say in Germany. Which, to be honest, but it's in poor taste.
Did you see that anecdote on Twitter today that someone said about Jeffrey Palmer that this person was doing an acting gig with him? I don't know when it was, probably a while ago. When Jeffrey got a call from his agent or a message from his agent saying that you've finally been paid for those Audi adverts.
Right, £7 million.
He got the message and he rang his agent back and said, "I think there are too many zeros on this check."
Right.
And his agent said, "No, there aren't. That's your fee." And apparently he was very happy.
Yes, I can imagine he would have been back then when you could make $250,000 for doing some adverts.
How much did you get for doing the Anusol advert?
I did that as a favour.
Oh.
And I didn't even get a free Anusol sample. No.
That's a bit rubbish, isn't it?
Yeah. I got a book token for Woolworths, and I was like, oh, nice.
That's dated this, isn't it?
Yeah.
Because Woolworths nearly made a comeback, didn't they, out of the mind of a 17-year-old boy?
Yes. Yeah, he did really well, didn't he, with that ruse?
He did, although it was immediately obvious that the account wasn't verified, was only followed by 100 people. So when it first appeared, I mean. So it was kind of obvious from the off.
Yeah, but that's what happened to Woolworths. It was only frequented by 100 people. And that's why
true. It's quite close. So,
there you go.
The biggest mistake Woolworths ever made is they brought in two mascots at the end. Do you remember them? There was two sheep and they were called Woolly and Worth.
Really?
Yeah.
Right.
And unfortunately, they were killed when the shop closed.
Oh, no.
I couldn't get my hair cut this week, Paul.
I know. You're very upset about that. You seem to have a regular haircutting regime, it would seem.
I do, every few weeks. And what you do is you book online because of the social distancing. So what I did is I booked online. I think it was Sunday. I thought, I'll get my hair cut this week, forgetting it was lockdown on Thursday. So I booked myself in for Friday morning. And I thought, oh, it's empty Friday. I'll go in and get my hair cut then. And then, of course, I got an email from them saying, you fucking idiot. It's lockdown, you twat.
So you favour the sort of Brett Anderson.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now you're going to slowly turn into Jeremy Brett.
I'd love to be Jeremy Brett.
Yeah. All right. Yeah. Well, why don't you be Jeremy Brett now?
Okay. I'm Jeremy Brett.
That's brilliant.
What I'll do is I'll do that thing he used to do with the patience, Watson. Patience. He used to shout.
I like that.
He used to shout in condensed sentences.
Yes. Who used to do that as well? Was it Nicole Williamson in the film Arthur?
Mm-hmm.
That's amazing. When he's Merlin.
Excalibur.
And 1 minute he's talking like that, and then he's back to normal. Well,
that's because it's a John Borman film and everyone's off their tits on something.
Yeah, of course. But
I imagine then Nicole Williamson as Merlin in the Dudley Moore film Arthur. Arthur, you're in the bath again. I shall conjure ducks.
I suppose you want me to wash your staff for you, you filthy little shit.
Sorry, are you saying Merlin is Arthur rather than being the butler?
Yeah, I recast it for the joke. Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, look, who's appeared?
What?
Graham's in the comments.
Oh, Graham's in the comments now.
He's obviously like Lawnmower Man.
Graham's in the internet.
He is in the internet, yeah.
Oh, he's like a wet egg Tron.
He's like a wet egg Tron.
Yeah.
Well, I can hear his voice now.
Yeah, but you be careful which websites you visit, Graham.
Because, of course, he died before pornography was prevalent. So.
Yeah, so if he finds that out, I don't think we'll ever see him again.
Oh, can I ask a favour of everybody in the comments? I think on behalf of both of us, if anything meaningful happens in the election, could you say? Not that it will, obviously, but if anything does.
Okay.
Hey, you know what? We've got a packed show this evening.
Yeah, we've got to plow on through.
Should we talk about things that...
Yeah, well, obviously today nothing major has happened on this day apart from Jeffrey Palmer dying, but let's find out what's happened on any other days on this day of days in days and days of days.
What a good link.
What happened on this day? What happened on this day?
What happened on this day? Well, I'll start us off. On this day in 1953, school children are given for the first time a free carton of milk at break times, which is subsidized by the government, replacing the old system of 20 B&H and a box of matches.
Oh, lovely. I remember that. That was on all the news.
Yeah.
On this day in 1964, during their very first promotional visit to the UK, the Beach Boys appeared live on ITV's Ready, Steady, Go, playing their very first hit single, Sand Up Me Arsehole.
I do remember it.
It was a huge hit.
I don't think there was a dry eye in the house when my mum and dad did their slow dance to Sand Up Me Arsehole on their wedding day.
Sand up my asshole.
And then that big conch. Beautiful. Well, on this day in 1972, R-Whites create a campaign, but with a pharmaceutical company, and a famous TV slogan stroke song is born. And I'll do it for you now.
Please.
R-Whites. Our white heroine, I'm a secret heroin taker. Our whites. Do you remember that? It's beautiful.
Oh, I remember that.
Creep down to the fridge and get his spoon out and his syringe.
It was Elvis Costello's dad, wasn't it? Famously.
Yeah.
And he used to sit there going, oh. And then the slogan was, just imagine a very fizzy bottle of lemonade times a million, and you're not even close.
I used to like it when he injected it all in and he went like that. And then he just looked at the camera and went, champion.
It's beautiful.
Lovely.
So advertising people knew what they were doing in those days.
They knew their onions, although they never advertised onions.
Weird that, isn't it?
Yeah.
On this day in 1971, the United States Atomic Energy Commission tests the largest US underground hydrogen bomb, codenamed Kalikin. Sadly, they tested it on a poor man's face.
Pity poor man. Well, on this day in 1897, Ooh. The very first public library is open to the British public. Now, back then, books were only available for 7 hours at a time, providing that you left a child on the premises as a deposit, and late returns incurred not only a fine, but compulsory national service.
Wow. Restricted in those days.
I remember that. You, sir, have not returned Lady Chatterley's lover within said time. I sentence you to 6 weeks at the front in Gallipoli.
To a time machine as well.
And that is well in stuff as well.
Well, Paul, on this day, in 1799.
Good Lord.
Sir Donald Cooper becomes the very first man to die in a balloon accident with his pet monkey Honda.
On this day in 1983, The famous Blue Peter Garden is vandalized.
Oh, God.
And, of course, it was all very hush-hush, but in the end, we found out that the culprits were, in fact, Johnny Rotten and Anne Diamond.
I can't believe Anne Diamond did that.
I can't believe she stooped so low.
I know, yeah. I'm Johnny Rotten.
There is a very small amount of security footage with Johnny going, "Come on, Anne, jump over the wall if you dare."
I'm a warrior.
Oh, by the way, those flowers, they're begonias.
I don't like stamping on butters. I love it. Butters, flowers. That was a Freudian slip. On this day in 1923,
good Lord,
as European inflation soars, one loaf of bread in Berlin is reported to be worth 140 billion hand jobs.
Those were the days, my friend. I constantly had a wet back. Anyway, on this day in 1986, the BBC children's show Finger Mouse branches out to the post-watershed adult market with a brand new spin-off called Cock Rat.
I watched that.
I miss Cock Rat.
1969, astronaut Ken Group becomes the first onanaut, having done the first wank in space, which sadly fell to Earth and decimated Tokyo.
Oh, ding a ding a ding 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 ding, wet.
Well, there you go. That's what happened
on this bloody day.
What happened on this day? What happened on this day?
I forget how brief our stings are now.
Yeah, I know. Sorry. That's something Trudy Styler has never said. So I suppose we should talk about the elephant in the room.
Baba.
Not Baba. The American election.
The American election. As American as cottage pie.
And fish and chips.
Fish and chips. Cottage pie and
opal fruits. Guinness.
And apple pie.
So the American election then, whose side are you on? Because when we were off air, you were saying you hope Trump wins. Why did you say that?
Well, I'm still trying to decide if Trump is a goodie or a baddie. I think he might be a secret goodie. I reckon Trump might be a bit like at the end of Harry Potter, where suddenly you go, "Oh no, Snape's really nice."
Yeah.
But I do hope I only find that out if Trump gets eaten and destroyed by a massive fucking snake.
Massive fucking snake. That'd be nice.
Massive fucking snake. Massive fucking snake. Donald Trump, who died today via massive fucking snake.
I would, what I'd do if I was a newsreader, because everybody's getting praise in the news today about actually asking him some sort of questions and saying that something he said is wrong. If Donald Trump did a death, I'd wait about a month until I said it on the news.
Did a death.
I'd say. What do you mean? I'd go. And before we leave you, we'd like to talk about some local stories in your area this week. So we're going to hand over to your regional network. By the way, Donald Trump died 3 weeks ago.
Oh, I see him do it like that. And then they'll hand over to regional. Well, I don't know about Donald Trump doing a death, but it's deathly cold here in Little Piddlington.
Mm-hmm.
We have to do a report about
someone that is the respect he doth deserves.
He doth deserve a doff of the do.
Not even that.
No, he don't deserve now. But I mean, I almost admire the brazen insanity of the man. I think that's the thing. I go, I'll miss that if he goes. Saying that, he will still tweet forever the real true president or something. I mean,
not if they suspend him. That's the rumor, isn't it?
Yeah, and I genuinely think he'll flee the country. He'll end up living on the Isle of Wight.
I'm hoping he turns into a flea and lives on a dirty dog.
Lives on an old dirty Democrat dog.
A Democrat dog. He's got the face of, like at the end of Invasion of the Body Snatchers, the dog's got the face of Joe Biden. Because that's the ridiculous thing about this election, isn't it? Is that you've got two very old men duking it out.
Well, I've heard the idea is that you let Biden settle in for 3 months and then he naturally
passes away.
And then it paves the way for Lady Vice President, New Wave, Left Wing.
Kamala Harris, yeah. Yeah. Who I've got a lot of time for. I think she's fun and nice.
Exactly. I think that'd be the plan.
I want
the spitting image plan. Puppet. We're not planning on Biden.
If I was involved with the spitting images, I would have the Joe Biden puppet be like Michael Foot, where every time he moves, like dust falls off him.
Dust, yeah. That Margaret! But obviously Joe Biden.
Joe Biden, yeah.
That's my game.
But I mean, clearly, out of the two of them, he's the one who seems sane. Because yeah, Trump's like this manifestation.
You can see, though, that the people around him have said to Biden, just everything you do now, just look the most calm, respectful. And it's so working. He just comes out going, let's see what happens. I probably won, but let's not get funny about it.
Did you see that video the other day where a knife wielding ape broke into his office? And he hugged the ape. And the ape was so touched, it dropped the knife and started crying.
Because he and an ape man. I'm an ape
That's
man.
Right.
I'm an ape man. Yes, I'm an ape man.
I'm a voodoo man. Don't know where that came from, Ray. I'm a King Kong man. I'm an ape man. This knife-wielding ape, who was called Mustafilis.
Right.
He came in through the top window that they'd opened because it was got a bit warm.
I believe he was Cheetah's second cousin.
That's right, yeah. He was upset about the way Cheetah was treated by Biden. He was upset about the way that Cheetah was treated. Upset about the way... It's like that song from Singing in the Rain. He was upset about... by Tarzan, who it turns out is Joe Biden's secret father.
I always wanted Tarzan to be referred to in the same way that the girl who fancied Roland in Grange Hill. Tarzan...
I'm just trying to be nice, Tarzan.
I'm trying to be nice to you, Tarzan.
We got some comments about the election here. Some of them nice, some of them not so nice. Does anyone think Biden will die in office? He might die in the bog. Fox knows the tastier part of the fox. Oh, bloody hell. Biden will definitely die in office.
Everyone has a fair crack of the whip here on the JP special.
Any relation to Honda? Yes, Mustafilis was Honda's great-grandson. Beautiful. Who gave this 3 thumbs up?
I see we have a critic in the house.
I see we have a critic. It was the orangutan chauffeur from Cannibal Run 2 that broke into Biden's orifice. That sounds a bit
far-fetched.
Tell you what, we're approaching half of the hour.
We should, yeah.
Why don't we check in?
We should.
With the old Cloud 9.
All right.
And appearing tonight on Peter Jones, Faith Brown, Bobby Nutt, Judy Cornwall, Windsor Davies, June Whitfield. And here's your host on Terry Wogan.
Avasti, mine hearties. Or should I say, howdy, partners. Because that's right, it's a special US of A edition of old Supermatch, open brackets, blankety blank, close brackets. Because old Tell's been watching from up on cloud, open brackets, nine, close brackets, what's going on over stateside. So I thought I'd theme it this week with an American edition. By the way, it's not just me going through the old rigmarole again. I'm joined as ever by my old cohort on his stallion. It's old John Rain. John, how fares thee?
Howdy, Terry.
Don't do it now.
All right. Hi, Terry. I'm fine. How are you?
That's better. So you've just been to the old town of Dodge up on Hangman's Hill, and someone shot you. Or something. We haven't rehearsed this, but
no. Yeah, I got shot in the arm.
Shot in the arm. Oh dear. Never mind.
Hmm.
Great. Well, that's the banter done with. Hmm. Let's start a game of the old Super Mat. Now, listen, I can't hang around for too long because I tell you what, old Terry's gone Swayze crazy. Oh, that's right, Swayze crazy. I'm getting dancing lessons from none other than Patrick Swayze himself. And I'll tell you one thing now. Nobody puts old Tell in a corner. Oh, yes. I'm going to be learning all the moves, but essentially that famous move from the dirtiest of dancing films, Dirty Dancing. And old Patrick has promised that he's going to hold me aloft and make suggestions. I completely fucked up the punchline to that. But there you go.
Hmm.
I'm going to look up and make suggestions.
I mean, you are dead.
I am dead, so, you know, timing's not necessarily my forte. Hmm. Now, let's have a quick game of the old Super Match. First person to type in Wogan's Weird Wimple, that's Wogan's Weird Wimple, gets to play. And in the meanwhile, I will summon down from high on heaven into the vessel that is John Rain, John Candy, American rotund funny man himself. Jonathan Candy, as I live and breed. How are you, sir?
I'm fine, Terry.
See, you're trying out an English accent there, John. I tell you what, you're doing it with great aplomb.
Thanks.
Lovely. Now, would you like to tell me any interesting anecdotes about when you were on Uncle Buck?
Well, when I was on Uncle Buck, one day when I was on Uncle Buck,
right,
something really funny happened.
Lovely. Skip to the end.
And he died.
Lovely stuff. And have you ever seen the porno version of it, Uncle Fuck?
No.
Ah, that's a real shame. Me brother was in it, but he was Key Grip, and that's nothing rude. Now, do we have anyone in the comments who's written Wogan's Weird Wimple, who gets to play the old Super Match?
I'm John Candy, and I'm
American woman.
I'm going to pick someone. A couple of people have answered straight away, but they've played before. So I'm going to pick someone who hasn't played before. I'm going to go with.
That's very magnanimous of you, John.
I go with Simon Duckworth.
Ooh, it's Simon Duckworth. Oh, well, hello. Simon Duckworth, you get to play the American Supermatch game.
Mm-hmm.
Let's reveal the legend. It's American blank. American blank. Now, you have a little think while we play the old thinking theme. Fum, 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 fum,
fum,
fum, fum, fum, fum,
fum, fum.
Lovely stuff. While you're thinking, me and old John Candy will come up with two answers of our own. You don't have to choose them. John, American blank, what say thee?
Well, Terry, when I was on the set of Cool Runnings,
all
the Jamaican guys used to say to me, John Candy, who ate all the pies? So I'm going to say American Pie.
American Pie, which I believe is an old classic by Don McLean.
By Don McLean. It has 467 verses.
Lovely stuff. And I'm going to go for American. Well, you went pie. I was going to go for pie. Never mind. Sorry. I'm going to go for American Spirit, which I believe was a brand of cigarettes, but is also a popular moniker in the old Midwest.
From Friends.
So, that's the one. So you can go with Wogan's Spirit, John Candy's pie. Never a word said in jest. Or Simon, you can come up with one of your own. Now, Simon Duckworth, ooh, do you have an answer? American Bungalow.
Oh.
Well, I tell you what, that's as good an answer as I've ever seen. Let's find out what the third most popular answer was for 50 blanks. It was, of course, yes, American Mouse. American Mouse there.
Big problem.
What do you mean, John? What, your diabetes? You mean vermin in general? No, you're not quite coming through there, John.
Yes.
Lovely stuff. So, you didn't quite get it there, Bungalow, but let's see what we've got for 100 blanks. The second most popular answer was, of course, American, please.
Which is what all Americans say in restaurants.
Yeah. What would you like to eat for dinner tonight, partner? American, please.
Uh-huh.
Lashings of hamburgers, key lime pie, and shrimp.
And a side of banoffee pie in a quaffy.
Quaffy and quayfish and a quape. All the American foodstuffs there, covered in fat. Now, let's see if you can do it for 150 blanks. Is it Bungalow? Everyone, just
I think
pray.
It might be. I think it might
pray
be.
Pray Bungalow. Could it be the time that we finally get the top answer on Supermatch? It's so close. It's not American Bungalow. It's American Avalanche.
Right.
American Avalanche there. There was a disaster today on the slopes of Mount USA. 400 people died in an avalanche, but don't worry, it was an American avalanche. You know, that sort of thing.
It was synthetic in some way.
Yeah, it was actually cream. Well, anyway, listen, old Tell will be back a little bit later on. He's got to get back up to old Swayze crazy himself. Mm. So I'll see you all very soon. Thanks for playing. I'll be back later. Until then, Avanti!
And appearing tonight on Peter Jones, Faith Brown, Bobby Nutt, Judy Cornwall, Windsor Davies, June Whitfield, and here's your host on Terry Wogan.
Well,
I'm leaving on a jet plane, gonna hit my nipple again. That was
John Denver famously left on a jet plane, didn't he?
He did, yes. I don't think he crashed into my nipple again.
No, he didn't crash into your nipple. He had a homemade plane.
He had one of those homemade planes.
He had a homemade plane that he built himself, which I like to imagine was a biscuit tin with two rulers sellotaped to the side. And he went off a cliff.
Yeah.
Singing, I'm going to die now.
Crash into the border.
It reminds me of that, you know, that Monty Python song. And now a song from John Denver.
Oh, yes.
You heard that one?
Yeah.
You came on my pillow. And then he gets threatened.
Yeah.
Mm. Disgusting. Outrageous.
Well, that thank you, Terry, for that American edition of Blanky Blank. He'll be back a bit later. Mm. We're steaming through the show. Any more comments before we move on a touch?
Paul's moustache gap is perfectly filled by the blue tack tip of Wogan's Wonder Wand fact.
Oh. Yeah, you're right.
There you go. American words. I guess that was another answer.
Or just something really severely out of context.
Well, the comments aren't being very helpful. They're just saying things like, stop the count.
Oh.
Which are you imagine them saying I'm some sort of Saturday morning kid show, like Run Around. Mike Reed going, stop the count!
Stop the count! I need to sit up in my rolled down wanking chair and go, ah!
What? Why have you gone for the different angle this evening anyway?
I just because this is my favorite spot, but I wasn't ever able to set it up properly because of lack of table. But right. found a table in the alley 2 days ago and cleaned it up and went, that'll fucking do.
You literally found a table in an alley?
Yes, yes. I live in London where tables are available in alleys whenever you want them, John.
It could be a drug dealing table.
I hope so. In that case, I'm going to fucking stop sawing
it
down.
Was there anything in it? Was there pornography in it?
No. It's a little wicker, shitty wicker table. Okay. But it's quite high.
So it's Alan Wicker's table.
It's Alan Wicker's table, yeah.
Here in Paul's spare room, luxury is only a footstep away.
Really,
you join us at the sun-kissed corner of Paul's spare room.
Well, that's really good. Can you now segue into Clive James?
I don't know. I'll try.
Paul's room, where the room gets Pauler and the Paul gets roomier. What?
On the information superhighway, where I'll be joined by Margarita Prangatan.
Margarita Prangatan!
She was a saint worshipper. No. Election update from Ben Thomas, still fucking counting. There's a lot of counting going on.
Counting like ballot votes from troops that are stationed overseas and they also come in later?
I don't know. I mean, it's fucking mad. How can a country that forward thinking, in inverted commas, be so weirdly backwards about everything? There's a bit of politics for you, ladies and gentlemen. Here in Paul's spare room, where the light hits the wall like Diana's driver.
Ooh.
Well, that's a bit too soon, isn't it? You know what? Because time's getting on. Getting on, ladies and gentlemen. It might be time to visit, if you've just joined us this evening, when Roald Dahl sadly passed away. We visited and found some unpublished Tales of the Unexpected.
Yeah, there's an interesting thing about Roald Dahl, because he did die in his sleep, but he didn't die in his own sleep. He died in someone else's.
Was he doing an Inception?
I don't know what he was doing, John. But
well, ladies and gentlemen, buckle in, because tonight's Tales of the Unexpected is about to begin. Well, shall I go first? Because you went first with the day.
Yeah, go on.
Okay, this one's called Hunting for R.
Hunting for what?
R.
Spelled
A-A-A-H?
A-R-R-G-H. Oh, as in R.
Yeah.
Okay, nice.
Don't ask me what it means. Caveman. Oh, what do you mean? I said don't ask me.
Oh, sorry.
Caveman Og Ogmanson was out hunting with his faithful dog, Mill. It was a pleasant day, much like any other. The sun was shining, the trees were glistening. Yeah, he'd been hunting loads of times. It was exactly like that. And he was after some buffalo for his tea. However, he would soon regret leaving the cave that day, and his blood turned to a very cold temperature. When, out of the trees, a lone, hungry, rampant T-Rex appeared and bummed him to death.
And that's quite rare, because they can't get a grip on the shoulders, can they? Yeah.
That's the tragic thing about T-Rex, is that they could never appreciate a cuddle.
Yeah, that's true. Well, my first gobbit is called Word for Widows. Foin?
What?
Malcolm Babybel invents but failed to patent the world's first ever word search.
Right. It
gains popularity and becomes very famous, and it's soon seen in newspapers all around the world. Except he didn't get the patent. Now, 40 years later, penniless and bereft, he takes his own life. His suicide note is found as a 20-foot by 30-foot word search. It takes the family 3 hours to work out why he did it.
Well, that was terrifying.
Simply Harrowing.
Harrowing. Well, this one's called Everything's a Gamble. Stockbroker legacy tumble dryer was nervous at his desk.
Legacy
tumble dryer. He just put the phone down to the Hong Kong office and his gamble had not paid off. He'd embezzled £10 million of his client's money. And not only that, he'd also signed his soul away to the devil in the process. As he sat there, assessing his options, he noticed the small print in the devil's contract. And before he could even absorb what it meant, his boss walked in with a policeman to witness him having to give birth to endless giant pineapples.
It was a cruel winter for that man. Hmm. Well, my next missive is called Sweet and Sour.
What?
Fool?
What?
Blackpool confectioner Derek Vape Pen has earned the reputation of being a cruel and angry shopkeeper. His penny-pinching, shady deals and bombastic attitude towards staff and customers means that his sweet shop is far from sweet. Local residents get their revenge by breaking into his shop and concocting a sweet justice. Within a week, Derek is now homeless. He's lost his house and his business when he discovers that the latest batch of rock, the stick of rock, has the word cunt written through it along with his PIN number.
Well, try not having nightmares later on, ladies and gentlemen. This one's called Hoot and I Will Come to You. Owl handler Balthazar Oinks was enjoying his Monday morning. He'd had a fine coffee and a splendid egg, and he was merrily making his way to his shed where he kept his prize owl, Baloo. But his face was to get much, much worse, and his day, in fact, when he opened the shed and the blood drained from his face, as instead of finding his beloved Baloo on his stand feeding on a mouse, he instead found...
No.
15 bank robbers in a car?
Chilled to the bone.
Terrifying.
Well, my next one is called Rock Off, Tommy. Completely mad and bi-curious hang on, I'll start again. Completely mad, bi-curious, disgraced vet, Tony Windows Vista, combined with Mad, curious, and disgraced vet Tony Windows Vista combines his obsession with the village people and an animal charity and shocks the audience at a local karaoke bar with his version of It's Fun to Stay at the RSPCA whilst dressed as an S&M bagpuss.
An S&M bagpuss. Will this desecration of our youth never end, Mr. Litchfield?
We will wax you. We will wax you, dirty old bagpuss in his leather pants.
This one's called Lunchtime Treat. Housewife Jennifer Googlet was in something of a pickle. As PC Testicles was round for his weekly cup of tea, she'd noticed the dog was barking at the door to the airing cupboard that contained the body of her dead husband.
Mm.
PC Testicle asked what was in the room, so quick as a flash, she hit him over the head with Bristol, posted Bristol to Cardiff, shot Cardiff with an ice arrow, boiled it in a pot, fed it to the local police station for their Christmas dinner.
What a postcode lottery. Well, this next one is called Golden Malicious. Legend has it that a young Sir Isaac Newton was hit on the head by a falling apple and came up with the laws of gravity.
No.
But very little is known about his second cousin, Sir Aubrey Vindaloo, who accidentally sat on an apple and came up with a butt plug. Foig.
This one's called Unprecedented. US President Donald Trump was not having a good day. Not only had he lost the US election, but he'd also found out from his private physician that rather than doing wheeze through his penis, he would now have to do all his wheeze through his nose. Also, just then, a T-Rex emerged from the cupboard and bummed him to death.
Two of your stories have ended with someone being bummed to death.
It's quite common, more common than you think.
And anyway, and also, John, they're not your stories, are they? They're Roald stories. So Roald must have been going through a bum to death phase.
I mean, yeah.
Now, my last story is called Snub Titles. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me, says local fuckwit Bernie Fondue. Give into it, John. Just give into it. Sticks and stones may break my bones, but names will never hurt me, says local fuckwit Bernie Fondue. So the next day, he is pelted by sticks with his name on them, but they don't hurt. The week after, stones are thrown through his window, but he is unharmed. Names will never hurt me, he shouts through his window. Names will never hurt me to his neighbours, who then immediately accuse him of being a pedo, stick him on the sex register list, and he's sent to jail, where he's given the nickname of Fuckbag.
I hadn't quite realised that goes on that long, to be honest. I thought it would be nice.
Surely, didn't the two Ronnies miss a trick, maybe doing a parody of that?
Someone did. Was it Spike Milligan?
Was it Spike? Surely the two Ronnies could have been me and Flo dancing on the go, giving you mysteries. He sat on a leak all last week. That sort of thing. Me and Pam, we've got a leg of lamb. We've got a little plan. You know, that sort of thing.
Ah, thank you. Peter Cook did it. Peter Cook did the piss.
Oh, Peter Cook did it.
Because, of course, that was whether Ronald is not a very mysterious name. Unless you remove the N. Yeah. Dwayne confesses they got frothy seeing a naked lady.
Cool.
And Wendy points out, I remember the credits. Yeah, I forgot them last week because I was quite drunk. I'm trying to get drunk tonight. It's just not happening.
Well, you're already slurring. Now, John, can you go through comments while I refresh my glass drink?
Yes. Goodbye. Yeah. Hey, everybody. Tim says, I tried to make a Smirch Pod Wikipedia page, but they told me it needs more reputable references, bastards. In revenge, I amended Bobby Nutt's page to say he invented Brillo pads. That'll learn him. I once amended a Wikipedia page to say there's a particular song by Roger Waters in which on his albums about the Hitchhiker, whichever, no, the one after the Hitchhiker album, where it was, he had loads of musicians on it, and I added loads of 70s light entertainment actors to it, and it was there for ages. And then eventually it got removed. But it had Arthur Mullard on there. So for a while, Arthur Mullard was on a Roger Waters album. Hello, John. Hello. Hello. Comments are mostly me and Claire being dicks, to be fair. Sorry, everyone. Don't worry about it. What chapter are you on? Well, with the book, I'm doing Cobra at the moment. It's about 80s action. So, yeah. You'll get there, John. What does that mean? That's a bit too sort of sexually encouraging. Arthur Mullard, wasn't he cancelled? Yes, very much so. Oh, there's a recount in Georgia. Let's all be honest. We all say, wow, this is going to be good. And then we don't really know what's going on. It's a very complicated procedure, isn't it? Can we expect a Dahl story next week? No, because we're not here next week. About a wicker table found in an alley that turns out to have 16 bank robbers in a car. That's a good idea. I might steal that. But yeah, we're not here next week. I'm having a rest because I have been doing stuff a lot and I don't want to. Claire, oh, hang on. Claire still needs Tinder advice. Just don't go on Tinder. My advice. It's horrible. I once entered a Wikipedia page of a comedian to say his childhood nicknames included Mugabe Jazz Benefit. And he's back.
Hello.
Hello. We were just talking about...
rum and Coke.
You got rum and Coke?
Mmm.
Wow.
What were you just talking about? I don't like it when I go to get a drink because I miss the comments.
I didn't miss much.
Hey!
There's a recount in Georgia.
Is there?
Trump aides have not much to do. I don't know if that's real or not.
They're probably just hosing down the soft play pit where he's currently lolling around like some beached whale.
Oh. I'm imagining, I said this to you off air, but I'm imagining, you know that bit in Robocop where Robocop on his first night goes to that mayor who refuses to accept the election results?
Yeah.
And Robocop has to punch him through the wall, drag him out and throw him through a window. I want that. How did John and Paul meet? Meet as in, because that sounds oddly sexual.
I contacted John on Twitter because he was in the middle of the very first incarnation, the very first series of what was to be the joy that is Smash Pod.
Yeah.
And I said, you don't know me, but. And he went, oh, I'm really sorry. Someone's already talking about your favorite Bond film.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe we'll do something in the future, but thanks for asking. Obviously, not knowing who the fuck I was.
But it's okay. We came back and we did it again, so it was fine.
Then I broke into his house and went, it's me, the man who tweeted you. And he went, we should work together.
But then we actually properly met when you did the Jaws of Revenge episode.
Yes, that's right. It's the first time I met you.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you and David Reed.
Mm.
Oh, yes.
Yeah, with a banana mama.
Hot off the press, Trump AIDS. He got it from a dirty monkey.
What I also like about once Trump has to leave the White House, he's going to go out one way, and then there's going to be a big long line of Melanias that are going to get less and less and less prevalent as they go out. I think the last one will be Jeanette Cranky.
What, you mean like a Russian doll?
It's just loads of the versions.
They're just gradually getting smaller.
Loads of the versions will come out just behind him.
I can't look at Jeanette Cranky since that she released that autobiography saying that her and her fellow were swingers.
Oh God, I don't want to know.
Yeah. Oh dear, yeah. David Reed. Yes, dear David Reed, he's lovely.
Yeah, we love David.
Superman 4 Smash, one of my favourites. That was a great night.
Oh, that was so much fun.
Yeah, we got to watch it in the cinema and then do a live.
It wasn't as bad as I thought it would be.
No, it was all right. It's all right. Yeah. So there we go. Well, we're approaching the top of the hour. So in that case, we need to have the phone number going. So call now on 0898 50 50 50. Calls cost 87 pence per second. Please ask permission of the bill pay before you phone in. And I am a bit drunk. Don't phone in. It's just for fun.
Are we playing it now? Are we playing it? Is it back?
What?
Please, can you tell me?
What?
Please, can you tell me who the fuck is that? Yeah.
It's good to talk.
It is indeed good to talk, Bob. Thank you for being here. Yes, we're back after not doing it last week and me trying another game, which, let's be honest, went down like a paedophile's funeral. This week, we are going to go back to the game that everybody loves and the jingle that everybody likes singing in their head. We're going to do Who the Fuck Is That? Now, if you've not played it before, because we have got new people in the comments this evening, I'm going to show you. Hi. We're going to show you some lookalikes, and I'm going to show one to Paul, then one to you, and you're going to guess who they are. You're going to tell me who the fuck is that?
Hang on, just before we begin, is it true that we haven't failed yet between me and all our listener viewers?
No.
So far, no one has. That's brilliant. That's a good track record. Okay.
Okay, so here's the first one for Paul. Paul, please can you tell me who the what is that?
All right. Is that the Fresh Prince of Bel-Air?
It is not.
Oh, okay. Is that Molly Sugden?
Not Molly Sugden.
Not Molly Sugden.
Not Molly Sugden.
My doggy. Is it this is dangerous territory because I'm going to start naming random black people and then appear like I'm saying.
Well, that's what's happening in the comments, so don't worry.
Yeah.
So I don't think anyone's going to get this one.
Yeah, all right. Well, that's because it's Sarah Brightman.
It's Sarah Green.
There's not a... I'm trying to think of anyone strikingly famous that he could look like.
It's not Kate O'Mara.
It's not Kate O'Mara, no.
Not David Hemmings.
David Hemmings.
It's not Richard Blackwood. It's not Wendy Craig. It's not Jason Derulo. It's not Big Willy. I'm going to have to tell you, aren't I?
Oh, my God. I've cursed this already.
Mm.
Paul. I said off the bat.
Paul, may I please introduce you and all our friends in the comments too? Jimi Hendrix. Jimi Hendrix.
Oh, my God.
That Jimi is Hendrix. Jimi Hendrix.
More like fucking Jimmy Horlicks.
What? More like Jimi Edwards.
There's no...
No.
I just don't get how he thinks. But
is correct. Fuck right off. Yeah, that is Jimi Hendrix.
Oh, my God.
Did you get much work, Jimmy? No.
Not much work.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, in the comments. Who's this?
Is it Elsa from Frozen?
No, it's not your turn. It's not Elsa from Frozen, no.
Oh, sorry. I thought it was Elfa from Fofun.
No.
Nice back shot, though. It's been nicely done.
It has. It looks a bit like she's in the nudie-doody.
In the nudder.
Yeah. No, it's not Sarah Green. Good guess. It's not her off X-Files. Not Katie Hopkins. It's not all of Steps. Again, I think I might have beaten the guys in the comments.
Is this going to be the ultimate round where John just defeats us all?
It's not Babs Windsor.
Also, the reason why you may defeat us all, John, is because they don't that your candidates don't have a fucking slim atom of a semblance of who they're supposed to look like.
No, not at all.
Is it Gillian? Is it Gillian Telfour?
No, you'll never get this. I'm going to tell you who it is. Everybody, ready?
No, hang on. Someone might get it.
Not really. Everyone's saying the same thing. It's not Bette Lynch. It's not. It's not Rusty Lee. It's not Princess Diana. No, I'm going to tell you who it is.
Dennis Wharton. Go on.
It's Felicity Kendall. Everyone. That is Felicity Kendall. Oh, Tom, I've grown carrots again.
Felicity Kendall.
Felicity Kendall.
Is it Fuckers-like?
Oh.
Also, she never said Tom. She always said Chom. She always pronounced the T with a CH.
She did.
Oh, Chom.
Fuck off is correct. Is fuck off. Right. That's 2-0 to me. Next one. Paul, who's this?
Is that supposed to be Cliff? No. Is it supposed to be? It's either Iggy Pop, which is not true. It's not. Or it's the Rolling Stones.
Oh, close.
Yeah, it's the lead singer of the Rolling Stones.
Mick Jagger, yes.
Mick Jagger, yeah. Yeah.
Okay, great.
There you go.
So, ladies and gentlemen, the comments. Oh. Can you tell me who this is?
That is Bob Pewter, the guy who three streets down does my dry cleaning.
Correct. No, he's not.
Hello, I'm Bob
Pewter. Indeed is John Lennon.
Oh, my fucking
I'm
God.
I'm John Lennon, and I'm here to open this branch of Summerfields.
Fucking John Lemon.
John. Okay. Paul, who the fuck is this?
I'll give it a go. Winner of official UK number one.
That's right. Oh, God, it doesn't say who she is, does it? No, it doesn't. No.
Looks like it says Lorried Brown.
Maybe that's her real name, but you have to guess who she's impersonating.
Is she impersonating Kate Bush?
She is. Fucking hell.
Well, it's just the hair, isn't it?
Yeah, okay, I'll give you that. Yeah. Right, ladies and gentlemen, the comments. Who's this?
Oh, God, that's so obvious.
Do you think?
Yeah.
Okay.
I love where the picture's been taken.
Isn't it? You got the fruit machine in the background. Indeed, it's Paul Hollywood. Never also, in the world history has a man been so ill-deserving on a surname like that.
You can tell by that picture that is not a bar in England. He's on his fucking holidays.
Yeah.
Because it's got the old floor that no pub would have that floor if it was in the UK. He's in Magaluf going, take a picture of me now, Pammy. I look just like him.
I bet he's got a soggy bottom. Hmm? Who's this? Who's this, Paul?
That's Paul McCartney.
That is Paul McCartney. And look, he's squeezing some tits. He's saying, you got a lovely pair of tits, like. I love squeezing these tits.
It looks like he's in the middle of the game where you go, tell me when to stop. John, tell me when to stop.
Yeah.
Tell me when to stop.
He might stop.
Ding dong, ding dong. My dick's that long. Did you never play that game?
I've literally never heard of that game.
All right, we'll do another version. Tell me when to stop.
Yeah. Okay, stop.
Ding dong, ding dong. Your mum's that long.
What? Okay.
Yeah, no, that she's that long.
Okay.
She's never played ding dong, ding dong.
I've never played ding dong, ding dong. My cock's that long. No.
Ah.
I don't think I'd get a ding out. I think he's resting on the heads of Duncan Goodhue. And Greg from MasterChef.
It looks like he's in a butcher's and he's trying to describe his perfect bird that he wants. You know, I want it about 9 pound.
And I said to John, I want a turkey this big. And he said, you won't, you know. And I've never forgotten that.
Do you mind if you cook the bird here? Because the missus don't like them.
She likes corn birds. Or quads, as they're called. Whose turn is it? Comments. Who's this?
It's comments turn.
Who's that?
That's fucking Neo from The Matrix, isn't it?
Mm, mm. Who's that, everyone?
I think I have an idea, but I don't know his name.
Come on, you bastards.
Well, I've got two now.
It is George Clooney.
Yeah, George Clooney.
Hello. I'm George Clooney.
Hello,
I'm here. I'm here to open this branch of Summerfield.
I'm George Clooney. I live in St. Ives. I'm currently without a current aboard. I'm in caravan static.
I tell you what, if he turned up at the nightclub,
he would be
probably working behind the bar. Thank you very much, everybody, for playing. That was another great game. Great game of.
Please can you tell me who the fuck is that? Yeah.
It's good to talk.
It's good to
talk. So, John, how long have we been playing Who the Fuck Is This? At least, what, 5 months now?
Well, I wanted to ask Tim, because Tim said at the opening of the show that it was episode 68, and I want to know if it is episode 68. We can't have been doing this for 68
weeks. No, it can't be 68 episodes, no, because that's more than this year.
Yeah, we started this in May.
Yeah, and that's the first time that we've been not only defeated, but defeated twice. On this day, ladies and gentlemen.
What happened on this day?
People did not quite play.
Any more election news, by the way, while we're waiting? Are we still going for a recount? Hang on, I'm just catching up in the comments. Several missed opportunities for Paul to do a Kevry Everett. Fucking hell. Kenny Everett.
Boobs! Cuddly Paul here. Boobs!
Justin arrived. The Straggler has arrived, sponsored by wine. Oh, yeah, we should say tonight's show is sponsored by
wine.
Go to www.wine.com for further information.
But also, this evening has been sponsored briefly by wine, which is twinned with rum.
Oh, yes.
That's rum.
Dwayne's chimed in. Election update. No, hang on. Fuck it. Sorry, the comments jump, you see. Election update, no change. That's no change.
That's no change, everyone. Election front. Yeah.
So what are we expecting to happen? What do we think the outcome's going to be?
I think it's going to be a brave new world, and everyone's going to get a million fairy kisses on their bum bum by unicorns, and America's going to float up into the sky, and it's going to rain hot dogs and drugs.
Unlikely.
Oh, nothing's going to happen. Donald Trump will eventually find out his fate, but he isn't out till January. Then he refused to come out. There'll be court cases pending. It'll all be a mess. America descends into civil war, and we just watch on the side, feeling slightly smug, whilst at the same time denying our own pitiful existence under our awful fucking Pillsbury doughboy Tory cunt of a government.
Well, it sounds to me like you're depressed, Paul.
No, I'm fine. It's just the usual baseline of...
Well, I've got something that'll cheer you up.
Oh, have you?
Yeah.
Have you? Oh, my God, Graham, you're back.
Hello, Paul.
Hi, Graham.
It's Graham.
Yes, I can see you.
I just wanted to arrive again.
Oh, it's lovely to see you, Graham. You look like a Tron supermodel.
That's the sort of look I was going for.
Oh, that's lovely. You still remembered to keep the list. That's nice. What have you been doing the last week? You've been living in the internet now.
Well, for the last week, I have been in the internet.
Yes.
And I went to eBay.
Oh, did you?
And I went to Amazon.
Right.
And I didn't like it.
Oh, no.
Because I followed a pop-up.
A pop-up what?
Advert.
Oh, no. And what was it? Was it an advert of something that you don't like?
Graham.
Yes, yeah, it is Graham. Graham, if you want to find some peace on the internet... Tom in MySpace has got some room in his one-bedroom flat, and you can doss in his living room if you want.
Paul, I was watching a program, and I just wanted to tell you something.
Oh yeah, what's that, Graham?
I'm very proud of you.
Oh, thank you, Graham. I'm so proud of you. The way that you held your head high as you hit that stone wall—that
was my last holding my head high.
It was, yeah. Can you remember the last time you held your head high?
Wednesday.
Yeah, Wednesday when? Can you remember
what you were doing? The accident.
That's right, yeah. Do you remember you were in the disco and you were doing Agadoo?
Push Pineapple.
That's right, Shake the Tree.
That's Graham.
It is Graham, yes.
I just wanted to tell you that I saw a program where you did the voice of a dog.
Oh, that's really kind of you, yes. That was lots of fun to do. Did you enjoy it?
I was so proud.
Thank you, Graham. That's lovely.
As proud as I was when I saw you with Nicola Finhurst.
No, well, that's obviously something, you know, I've got that scene tattooed on my back.
But I also bring you a message.
From beyond the grave?
Yes. The future.
And it will be.
Donald Trump.
Yes.
He is a president. He will beat Hillary Clinton in the election.
Right. Okay. When's this going to happen, Graham?
2016.
Oh, great. Graham, yes, listen. Yes. It's 2020 now.
It's Graham.
Right. Okay.
Paul, I'm fading.
Oh, no. Oh.
I'm fading, Paul.
Take care, Graham. Oh, he's gone. He's gone.
What happened there? Well, I got cut out of the feed. I don't know what happened. Yeah,
John, I don't know what was going on. You were furiously texting me going, what the fuck is going on? It was Graham, John. It was Graham again.
It was Graham again, was it?
Yeah, he came back. He invaded the airwaves.
Wow.
Yeah.
Wow. I mean, how do you feel about seeing him again?
Not as emotional as last time, but still pretty bilious.
Bilious.
Yeah.
So what was his funeral like? Do you mind me asking?
We didn't have one.
Oh.
No. It's because when he went through that wall, he went through at such speed. It was a bit like jamming, I suppose, a bit like jamming mustard through a sieve. He just sort of, and he sort of like scattered across behind the wall, which was a lawn, sort of like a Graham mince. And we just thought, actually, he quite liked nature, and we just thought he's just gone back to nature. I mean, obviously a couple of birds and a couple of badgers and some foxes had a go at him, but and we took the bones and we threw them away.
Do you feel any guilt? Because I know that you put those water skis on him. Do you feel any guilt about it?
Well, I did at the time, but I remember everyone saying, "This is just get the measure of it, Graham. This isn't that you need to be in the water." But he insisted on, you know, he went, go for it. And, you know, the stupid prick in the speedboat, he went hell for leather.
Accidents happen.
Accidents happen. And sometimes they can be planned and still happen.
Dwayne's got an election update.
Oh,
Biden
yeah.
appears close to winning the presidency after taking the lead in Pennsylvania with 98% of the votes counted. If he wins Pennsylvania, he wins the White House. Thank you, Dwayne.
Doesn't Pennsylvania have like a ridiculous amount of college votes, or whatever they call it, like 11 or something mad?
I have no idea. I wish I did.
I don't understand, because I always thought, like, surely the amount of college votes that you get should be according to the size of the state, because you get weird places like fucking Buckner, Arkansas. It's got like, you can fit like 400 UKs in it and they have three votes. And then you go somewhere like Maine, which is basically the size of a fucking pea, and there's like seven. I just don't understand how they get to those numbers.
I wish I could say, having sat through 400 consecutive fucking nights of this election, I knew what was going on. As we've got a packed show this evening and it's 10:15, it might be time for us to visit Cloud9 again.
No, before we do that, let's
in here, John.
Let's get in here.
Fair enough. Let's go. Let's visit Paul's mind and my mind.
Okay, so it's fair to say, John, we've had some ups and downs with this.
But we've been on the same track, I think, for a few weeks. There's like been little nuggets of similarity.
The connection has been slow. And that's mainly because, obviously, your mind is a bit and which is fine. You know, there's nothing wrong with that. It might just be the sea air of Worthing. I'm not sure.
Possibly.
So what I decided to do, because we've tried sort of like anything goes. We've tried then sort of like going down to something very particular. We tried the films of
Kubrick,
and that almost got us there. And there were times where we sort of by chance, sort of almost, to use the gay phrase, we almost docked with our minds. But instead of unfurling our foreskins onto each other's foreskins, we just met via the mind. So I thought this time, well, I thought this morning, I left it till this morning, didn't I, John? I didn't even say anything to you. I just said we seem to have our closest connections sometimes with cartoon characters. And I think there's a reason for that, which is because the joy of being a child and the joy of youth is when your mind is just at its most open and it's accepting everything. And I wanted to just recapture that joyous moment of youth with you. And and the remit that I said to you, John, was draw any character from the many, many, many shows that were made by Hanna-Barbera.
Yes, and, that's right.
Now, that covers so much. Inch High, Private Eye, Wacky Races, Scooby-Doo, The Jetsons, Top Cat, The Flintstones. There's just so much. So you started drawing this morning at a very precise time, and because I was on the phone with you, and I just said, John, start drawing now. And then I hung up. And then I started drawing.
Yeah.
And I felt it immediately. Mm-hmm. And I think we finally cracked it this time. And I'm quite happy because we're going to have a week off. And I think this is the time to just bed it down and finally prove to you all that we have a psychic connection. So, Hanna-Barbera cartoon characters, there are millions. Now, I already know the answer to this. Did you choose the Flintstones? Say yes or no. Did you choose the Flintstones?
No.
No, you didn't. Of course you didn't. Did you choose Inch High, Private Eye?
No.
No. No, you didn't. Did you choose maybe Captain Caveman?
No.
Well, you didn't. Did you, in fact, John, choose Scooby-Doo?
Yes.
I fucking knew it. This is it. This is the moment. This is it, John. We are finally going to nail this. Ah. Mm-hmm. Okay. We chose Scooby-Doo. Not Scrappy-Doo and all that junk. Scooby-Doo, purist. Scooby-Dooby-Doo, where are you?
Where are you?
Yes, 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 yes. John, show your picture to the world. I know, oh, fuck a duck.
What? What's the problem?
No, it's a really good picture of Scooby-Doo.
And I'm guessing, I mean, this is me reading my mind's eye. You've done Scrappy-Doo, right?
No.
Velma?
Yes.
You've done Velma?
Yes.
Oh, well, that's fucking brilliant. I mean, that is like literally the same room.
Yeah, but it's they're five fucking characters. I could have gone with Daphne or Shaggy or Scooby or... Oh, God. So close. Okay. So close.
So my Scoob against your Velma, and then I think you can literally like slot them together, and then you've got an episode of Scooby-Doo. You've got like a cell frame of Scooby-Doo. So can we see your Velma, please? And then we can...
Yeah, of course.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
There she is investigating.
What have you done?
She's looking for clues.
What have you done?
She's looking for clues.
But what have you done?
What? She's looking for clues. I don't know what you're...
That is like something you find by a train track.
I don't know what you mean.
1987.
Oh, right. Okay. So you can maybe see a Scooby snack. But that's by the by. That's what I thought you were thinking about.
Oh, for fuck's sake.
That's what you were thinking about. Oh, Do you know, really?
I mean, this took me ages. And you've made slash fiction.
I made a true depiction of what you were thinking. And it's
that may well be
looking for clues. I don't know. Words fail me.
Well,
you're taking diabolical liberties.
Maybe the week off will.
Maybe that'll strengthen the bond. Go. I tried to comb my hair, but my hair wasn't there.
How long are you going with the moustache for? Come on.
Instead, there was a girl named Claire, except she wasn't there. I don't know. Many people have been saying, are you doing it for November? And I went, no.
No. Well, there isn't
a until I get bored. I'll get bored with it. Until then, I'm going to enhance it and enjoy it.
Well, quite right. I had to actually shave my own face yesterday like a fucking savage.
Really?
Well, because I couldn't get in the fucking barbers, could I?
I've never seen you perfectly clean shaven. You always have a bit of a Jeff Capes.
Jeff Capes?
Well, a little goatee.
Jeff Capes. I mean, this is probably as close as I've gone for a while. I just...
Can you do that with your tendons in your neck?
No. No, what the fuck is that? You look like some sort of robot. God, that's disgusting. Don't do that.
I know it's disgusting. I've got a really long neck.
Why the fuck did you do it?
What did you do to like me, John?
Huh?
What did you do to like me with my
robot? The way to go to do it. It looked like some sort of horrible cock.
Terminator.
Is that... That's horrible. That's... No. I don't like that. Don't do that again.
Well, I won't.
Paul auditioning for robot heroin addict when he does that with his neck. Yeah, quite right.
Thank you. Listen, I wouldn't mind the work.
What was the last gig you had?
June?
No, what was it, though? I'm not asking for dates.
It was just doing voiceovers. That's the last thing I've done.
What was the last advert you did?
That was for Uber.
Oh, wow.
No, honestly, it wasn't. It was in a fucking depot in Watford. And the cars that picked us up were Addison Lee, which I thought was a bit odd.
That's a bit odd. Bit of a crush.
Yeah, like, surely you'd pick me up in the... but there you go. Yeah. No, it was shit. And that was... I had one line in the background, but then they gave me two lines. So then I rang my agent and went, actually, they've given me more lines, which means I'm officially a feature artist. And she went, no, you're right, if you've got more than... So she then rang the producers live on the set. And then a woman came up to me and went, can you just sign this contract now, please? And I went, what do you mean? She went, oh, we've altered it. And I went, well, I don't look at contracts. You have to send it to my agent. She went, no, you sign that now. And I went, No, I'm not signing anything. I know that you know that I've spoken to but that's what you do. And she was really shitty. And she said, well, we can always cut you from the advert. And I was like, wow. Absolute cunt.
Same thing happened to John Merrick.
Yes, same thing happened with John Merrick, yeah.
Yeah, when he was doing those Flash adverts.
Yeah.
No, he did, do you remember those Sell It Bang adverts? No, Vanish, when the woman comes out with the siren on her head. He comes out going,
well, he was the original toilet duck, but people screamed when they saw him in their system.
His job, you know his job when he was a teenager? Yeah, seriously, I swear to God, this is true. John Merrick's job when he was a teenager, before he went to the circus, was a door-to-door salesman. Honestly. He'd be selling wares. Can you imagine opening the door to the Elephant Man?
What was he selling? Unless the answer is big fucking hats.
Well, he'd be like,
feather duster, ironing board cover, nightmares.
Actually, I'll have four of your nightmares, please.
Certainly.
Well, there you go. Here we go. Joe Biden says people should remain calm as votes are counted, adding he has no doubt he will emerge as the winner.
Yeah, he said that earlier. Yeah. He has won, hasn't he?
He has won.
Which is
lovely. Interesting question from Dwayne. Did John Merrick wank? Interestingly enough, the only part of John Merrick that was unharmed by the horrible affliction he had was his genitals.
Was it his Johnson?
Yeah. But he couldn't obviously hold his Johnson because he had crab claws.
Oh.
Or as Frank Skinner said, the only part of his body that was unaffected by the affliction was his genitals, unfortunately, or his head.
He genuinely,
his genitals were completely 100% unaffected by...
I wonder if that meant, because of the nature of his physique and his deformity, that actually his genitals stood out as being absolutely beautiful because they were enhanced by the nightmare around it. Like, actually, if you saw John Merrick's cock under balls, you're actually like, pretty good. Pretty good.
Do you mean like if you were walking around the realms of hell and there was a Starbucks?
Yeah, it stands out. You're like, I don't mind a little bit of that.
Merrick's facial deformities rendered his speech increasingly unintelligible, and prospective customers reacted with horror to his... This is when he was going door to door, by the way.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, yes, that makes perfect sense.
It does. You're going to have to fill for it because I'm going to go and get a drink.
Okay, that's absolutely fine. I can't answer comments, so I just need to ramble, don't I? What do I say? I don't know what to say. I haven't had any work since June. wonderful. And fell in the cracks with the old self-employment help. So no money there. I couldn't get universal credit because of the old ball and chain. Don't. What's your favourite voiceover, Paul? Oh no, I can see the things. That's brilliant. Yeah, let's just do that. Why do I have to fucking pretend to do shit when I can answer questions? To answer your question, Edward Llewellyn, what was my favourite voiceover voice? Actually, when I did Miss the Sheep Pup, when I was doing the dog on Channel 5 with Brian Blessed and Mel Gedroych, I had a small part as a crow, which I did as Kenneth Williams, and that made me just howl with laughter a lot. That was good. Well, I don't know yet about that, Tim. Paul, tell us about doing voiceovers for computer games. I've done the little teaser trailer for Dark Tide, and I'm going to do the game when they've made the game. Oh, Dutch Supermarket Joy. Yeah. So if you're not listening to Total Joy, everyone, there's a really lovely supermarket that advertises on there called Shod. And that's done by a Dutch guy. And there's a rival company called Mabbins, but don't buy anything from Mabbins. There'll be a new episode of Total Joy coming out soon. We've got semi-regular bits and new sketches. And also John and I talk about four things, two each, of things that have brought us joy in our lives. I might talk about JP's special. And that's why John's an absolute... Oh, he's back the shit.
Oh, my God.
That was really nice because I can actually see the comments.
Yes, I came here and made that happen for you.
Did you do that?
Not for the first time, yeah.
Oh, Izzy Wizzy, let's get busy, aren't you? Good. Well, look, it's 22 of the 30.
That means it might be time for...
Appearing tonight on Derek Griffiths, Peggy Mount, Patrick Moore, Anna Dawson, Paul Daniels, Lorraine Chase, and here's your host on Terry Wogan.
Avast thee, mine hearties, tis old Tell back down once again. From the old cloud, open brackets, nine close brackets, for another game of the old Supermatch. Now, it's an American theme Supermatch this week. But listen, I can't hang around too long because, as you know, time is a little bit different. Oh, no, cloud open brackets, nine close brackets. Last time I spoke to you, I was having lots of fun with the old Patrick Swayze man himself. But since we last spoke, maybe half an hour has passed here on the evil realm that is planet Earth. But up there, about, oh, gosh, 2.5 weeks have gone by. And I tell you what, I've been very, very, very busy. In fact, I cannot tarry too long because I'm getting music lessons this evening. Oh, yes, John, music lessons from none other than ta-ta-ta-ta. That's right, old Tin Ear himself, Ludwig van Beethoven. Oh, he's been teaching me how to play a variety of instruments. I tell you what, Mrs. W suggested that old Tell take up the root-toot flute. That's right, the flute. Oh, dear. And imagine her surprise yesterday when she burst into the living room with a plate of bourbon biscuits to find old Tell himself with Ludwig's instrument in his mouth, making a high-pitched noise as he helped me finger the shaft. But that's by the by. We're here to play the old Supermatch game. Take that grin off your face, Rain. This is serious stuff. It's the old Supermatch. Yee-haw! Marlboro Light, American Pie, American Edition. Now, before we play the game, we need a contestant. So the first person to type with their stubby little digits, Wogan's Wobbling Wimple. That's Wimple. Wogan's Wobbling Wimple gets to play. In the meanwhile, I'll conjure down another celebrity from the old cloud open brackets, night close brackets. And I'm joined by someone now. You may not know this man by face and by voice, but you'll certainly know him by name because you've been in him. What does that mean? Well, let me introduce you to none other that way. John Lewis. John Lewis, owner of the old Fancy Pants Depot of Joys and Dreams.
He's hello, a Paul.
A little bit gaseous and bilious, but he's with me now. John, how are you, sir?
Hello, Paul. Lovely to see you. Terry. Terry, of course. I meant Terry rather than Paul.
Of course you did. Don't worry. So, John Lewis, you've left behind a legacy of rather affluent stores selling a right load of old tut for inflated prices. Well done.
Hello, Terry.
Yes, hello, Terry. Wonderful.
You know, the best thing about working with my wife, John Lewis, she works in the old lingerie department.
Oh, yes.
And she won't let me try anything on.
What, you want to try on her underwear?
Yes.
Right. Well, that's great. I mean, do you prefer a peephole bra and crotchless knickers, or you're more of a gym pant man?
Gym pant man all the way.
Gym pant man all the way. Hockey yeah. Knickers. Hockey knickers, not a care in the world. Hail a taxi. Whoopsie daisy. Great fun down in Soho.
Absolutely.
Lovely stuff. Well, we'll be checking in on John throughout the Supermatch game. Now, Matt Crow. Matt Crow was the first one. I believe Matt Crow's a regular player. Is that right?
That's right, Terry. Well, technically, Dwayne was first, but he put Wagner's Wobbling Wimple, which is not correct.
That's correct. Disgusting. In fact, you'll find that Wagner's whatever Whipple is a forbidden spell in the Harry Potter universe. We're not going to go there. So absolutely. It's Matt Crow who's playing for the crown that is Yeehaw! President Yeehaw Steak and Onion Supermatch, the American edition. Now, we've mentioned this word a few times because it is synonymous with the old US of hay. Let's reveal the legend. Thank you, Eugene. It is, of course, blank pie. Blank pie. Now, Matt, you have a little think. I'm going to lob it over to old John Lewis. John.
Well, Terry, as you know, for many years as a retail giant.
Can I just stop you there, John? I mean, I remember in 1999, I went in to buy a salt and pepper cellar for old Mrs. W in one of your stores. And the cheapest one I could find was $28.99. Now, unless those two fuckers were dispensing gold and diamonds, how do you justify the price?
fucking hell.
Oh, well, that's justified with me. Lovely stuff.
Well, the answer is, of course, in terms of pie, as someone who runs a fairly large retail company in the United Kingdom, the first word should, of course, be penis.
Well, there. Penis. So, John, you're going to go with penis pie.
Penis pie.
Penis pie. Well, that's...
Penis pie.
Penis pie. Well, thank you, John. That's...
Penis pie.
Yeah, slightly at a left field there, John. Old Tell's a bit of an old traditionalist at heart, and he's going to go for good old traditional mama's apple pie. And there's nothing more American than apple pie. Now, Matt, before you come up with your final answer, you can go with old Wogan's apple, or you can plump for a lovely old go on John Lewis's penis. It's entirely up to you.
Absolutely. There'll be a fairly large cube, but I'll get to you eventually.
Yeah, well, there'll be a few fucking returns and refunds. Now, Mackerel says, now, coupled, go American apple, or Greg's toe and cheese? Now,
what is it, Matt?
That, of course, was in the question of, it came in the form of a statement and not a question. So I'm not sure if he's going to go with Old Tell's American apple, or whether he's going to go with Greg's toe and cheese. He's going for Colosseum pie!
What a bloody brave choice.
Colosseum pie. Yeah. And I will say at this juncture, Matt Crow, that might be slightly funnier than I came up with. But I tell you what, it's an absolute joy to have you play Colosseum pie. I may shout that now every time I go into Greg's. But let's find out what the answers are on this Yeehaw American Hoedown edition of Blankety Blank Supermatch Game. Thank you, Eugene. It was, of course, blank pie. Let's find out what the third most popular answer was. For 50 blanks, is it Colosseum pie? Could it be? Dare it be? Might it be? No, it's not be. It is, of course, Schmuck's pie. Why'd you eat that pie?
Well, no, Terry, I mean, I have traveled the world considerably.
Right.
And I must say that when I have been to certain areas of the United States, particularly New York, there's a certain kind of pie that's very popular with the indigenous guy creatures of New York, right, which is called a schmuck pie, which is a lot of soy and a great deal of apple.
Apple. Lovely stuff there. New York, the big orange. Now, let's go over to 100 blanks. Please let Colosseum be in there. I mean, I really hope it's in there, to be honest. It's funnier than whatever the fuck I've written. And you need to win because of that. But no. For 100 blanks, the second most popular answer, excuse the blue tack, is Calamity Pie.
Calamity Pie, of course, musical made famous by Doris Day.
An anecdote for every... No, go on.
Doris Day, of course, was a regular in the John Lewis in London, where she would often come in and she would close off the entire floor. Yeah. Just close off the entire floor just to buy one sofa. And then in the end, of course, we couldn't get the bloody thing in her car.
Right. She never closed off your windpipe, though, did she? Now, if for 150... Sorry, just a hair in the gate there, old Mr. Lewis. 150 blanks. Let's cross everything we can cross legally. Please, Colosseum pie. It's such a good answer. Colosseum pie. Oh, Matt, I feel for you and all your family. I'd like to feel all your family, but I can't because I'm dead. The most top answer was, of course, it's so obvious, Hollywood pie.
Well, of course, Hollywood Terry. I went to Hollywood in the 1980s.
Yeah, well.
And I tried to open a branch of John Lewis on the Sunset Strip, but of course, the retail prices then were extraordinary.
Extraordinary prices.
They were extraordinary.
Lovely.
So in the end, we didn't.
Right. Good Lord. Well, that was an absolute joy, John. You really kept the old airwaves a-flowing with your anecdotes there.
Well, of course, Terry, it's lovely to be here.
It ends with tell. Tell has the last word in this... terrible sitcom that we call Jay of Lewis. It's been an absolute joy to have you. I'm glad we're not neighbors. I think you might have a small dick. Avanti!
And appearing tonight on... Derek Griffiths. Peggy Mount. Patrick Moore. Anna Dawson. Paul Daniels. Lorraine Chase. And here's your host on Terry Wogan.
I've just realised what the problem is. Why we've been getting I've just realised what the problem is because there's no clue for her to look at. Of course, right. That's why people are getting all weird about it. All right. Thank you, Terry.
Thank you, Terry. Yeah, as usual. So we're in lockdown again.
Yeah.
Which is the whole reason this fucking thing started. And just when it looked like we were heading out, in the words of Michael Corleone, they pull us back in. We're here for lockdown. And obviously, unfortunately, we won't be here next week because we're not. But the week after, we'll be here, and, you know, for some considerable time.
But also, we'll be recording a new Total Joy. There'll be a new Wheeze and Groaning. And there'll be loads of fucking back catalogue stuff that John does with his million other brilliant stuff. So there's loads for you to enjoy.
Enjoy is a rather loose term, but yes.
And also remember, once we come out of lockdown on the, was it 2nd of December, nothing will have changed. Oh. And we'll have a really shoddy December, and then that will carry on until round about June, July next year. So,
well, who knows? This time next year, we may all be in the same room doing this. Wouldn't that be fun?
It would be a lovely thought. It's a lovely thought because I've got several ideas of how that show would work.
As have I.
They're risable, they're valuable, they're soluble.
They're irrelevant. Doable. They're irrelevant.
And they're doable.
And it's here on the stage of a London venue where John and Paul...
Full circle.
Back to where John and Paul have... bathed in the low rays of the sun and unveiled their new idea for a live show, which was brought to you on the Information Superhighway by Margarita Prakatan herself, who is now dead, of course.
So TARDIS is trying to drink my rum. TARDIS, don't drink my rum.
Don't let cats
drink. Don't do that to Velma.
John's curtain just moved and Paul's Rothko inverted colours and then went back. What's going on? This curtain thing is ridiculous.
Well,
To the point where poor old Paul, lovely Paul, believed one of the pictures that was posted that I had a ghost in my house.
I did. It was really well done. Whoever did that mock-up of a tiny little, like, sort of squirrel's face, like bandit, squirrel, rapist, stroke thing, did a really good job.
You could always escape across the border. Isn't Wales utterly fucked in terms of lockdown? Am I wrong?
No. Wales have got their own separate things. So,
Are they opening up tomorrow? Is that?
I'm not sure. It's all really weird because one of my old friends in drama school, her daughter's in Liverpool as a tattoo artist and is now trapped in Liverpool. Couldn't go back to Wales because Wales is completely locked down.
Liverpool's not going to be like.
Yeah, it's very weird.
Yeah. John and Paul's Puppetry of the Penis channel. Like, no.
No, I think if anything, we'll do Japanese kabuki of the balls.
Oh, when is the picture auction? You know what? We should probably do it soon because then we can do a round two later on if lockdown lasts longer than it should. So maybe we'll put those up soon.
Yeah. I will do it. I'm not sure how I can get your money off you, but we'll try and work it out.
We'll figure it out. I think it's like GoFundMe or something, isn't it?
Something like that. It'll be good to do it after this one because we've got 12 now, so that's a nice even number.
Yeah. You can all bid for Paul's incredible pictures. And raise money for cancer charities. Why not?
Yeah, if you would, because it was three days ago when my poor old mummy died.
Oh, how many years?
It's 4 years now, which is very odd.
Sorry, Paul.
That's all right. And in 2 days' time, it will be the funeral, which is which is weird, really, than the day she died is more upsetting to me somehow. I don't know why. Well, no, I do know why. One of the reasons was I was the only person who spoke at the funeral because being a performer, the entire family went, oh, Paul will do it. And this one time I never wanted to fucking ever be on stage or do anything or talk to anyone. And obviously I did it. And that was just, I was in bits and it was all very dramatic and awful. But anyway, yeah. So we want to raise money for Macmillan, I think, because they helped my mum a lot before she left. So it'd be really cool. She's only 67, bless her, when she went. So she was very young. But also, I'll be honest, it was her fault because her doctor had to ring up to the house, I remember at the time, and go, hello, Linda. My mum's called Linda. Hello, Linda Littrewood. I'm your doctor. You don't know that because I've not seen you in 14 years. So I think my mum knew things were afoot, but never decided to bother anyone. So there you go. Bless her.
Bless her.
We'll raise money for something brilliant, and that would be lovely because you're the best.
We'll raise money for Linda.
Yeah, let's do that. That would be lovely. I've got a picture of a... I'll show you the picture, actually, because it's really nice because it combines my two ultimate loves. One, my mummy, and two, Doctor Who. Isn't he lovely?
Oh, that's like my nan, who was John Pertwee. Seriously, folks, my nan looked exactly like John Pertwee. And towards the end of her life, bless her, she used to come round our house. She used to come round our house and she'd want to watch video. She'd want to watch telly with her headphones on. And when she'd sit there, I'd poke my dad in the elbows and say, Davros.
So about 6 months before she died, I managed to get her up to London and take her for high tea and stuff because we knew that things were not going to... It was a terminal sort of diagnosis. So she had her last trip. She was a bit weak at the time, and I took her for high tea and bits and bobs. But the one thing, because she knew that I loved Doctor Who so much. And so we went to the BBC, and we had this lovely little picture of us together. And obviously, she's got her little hair there and under a thing because she refused to wear a wig. So we managed to have that last little pic. So that's a very special pic for me.
Well, is that a TV centre?
Yeah, we just popped into reception.
It's by reception, isn't it? Yeah.
Yeah. On the way in, we saw, is it Andrew O'Neill? No.
Andrew Neil.
Andrew Neil, yeah. Andrew Neil was coming out in the morning and went, good morning. And my mum was just like almost like, did he arrange that? And I was like, no, that's just what happens when you come to places like this. She was so happy that someone famous came out and gave a good morning.
That's lovely.
Yeah, he's all right. It's a shame it was Andrew Neil. I was expecting, you know.
It'd be better if it was Stringfellow Hawk from Airwolf.
Yeah, or fucking Chesney Hawkesand. No. I don't know what that means. But that would have been nice. So, yeah, we've got a long lockdown. I think Christmas is going to be fucking insane for everyone.
Yeah. But we'll be here. And also, we will, I think maybe while we're off next week, we'll talk about maybe putting all of Paul's pictures in for an auction.
Yeah, and we'll do it. We'll do it live in the show when we come back, either next time or the time after. But we'll try and get it done during this lockdown because we've got loads now, and that'll be brilliant. There's a new JP special that'll be coming soonish because we've sort of half written it and half our
Total Joy. You mean?
Sorry, not JP. Total Joy. There's two Wheezing Groanings already ready to go. And we're going to be doing some more before Christmas specials.
Mm-hmm.
I've already regretted my choice. I won't mention what it is, but when we chose the next ones we're going to do, I chose it just completely out of the ether, and I watched the first two episodes, and I've never been more bored in my life.
Yeah, it'll be fun. It'll be fun.
That's amazing.
So yeah, we got lots coming up, and also we'll set up the auction. And I just wanted to say, actually, thank you very much. I mean, because we're going to have a week off next week, but. Thank you, everybody in the comments, for sticking with us for so long. And for putting in for the Total Joy thing, which we really enjoy doing. It's a bit of a creative thing, and also it's just fun. And just having you guys here every week is lovely. And then we've all got these little shared private, not private, you know what I mean? Like, shared jokes.
It's like having a little gang, a little club, and that's the only thing I can take out of what's been going on since March and is things like this, because it's just a nice little moment. I've also weirdly been more in contact with friends that I maybe should have seen physically, more so than I ever have done, just because of the nature of being stuck at home. And weirdly, that's been another nice thing.
It'll be weird to look back on in a couple of years, but I think genuinely...
Yeah, well, when we get to the 2 years' time, obviously we won't speak to each other ever again, and, you know...
Hand on heart, I'll look back on this lockdown period when we were there every Friday just pissing about and sharing jokes with everybody in the comments. It's just a very, very lovely thing.
Mm.
So thank you very much for all being there. Can we have some JP Special Club badges? If anyone wants to make them and send them out, you have our blessing.
Mark, I used to know someone who used to make badges at the Edinburgh Festival on the cheap, but I think they were only cheap if they made like 5,000. So
yeah, that's how it works. But if anyone wants to do that and then chuck us like 10 quid or something, by all means, do that.
And merchandise. We got endless merchandise opportunities. Not that I want anyone going out wearing some of the stuff that we've said, but
some of it.
The idea of someone going to Buckingham Palace to watch their granny be knighted and they've got Roald Dahl's Wanking Shed written on their...
Not do that. No. No. But yeah, genuinely, thank you very much. We're going to have a week off next week because we deserve it. We'll be back the week after and it wouldn't be the same without any of you. So thank you.
Cha-cha.
Well, we've still got 6 minutes.
This will be gone as well, I think, because it's a bit weird.
You can get rid of the tash.
Maybe. Mm. I don't know. I'm very much... Yeah. I mean, the good thing is when you have this sort of moustache, I don't go out, so it's fine. No one has to really see it apart from when I'm on here.
Yeah, I mean, I could probably cultivate some sort of thing like that soon because I'm only working 2 days a week. So to the comments before we go, Mark Henderson says, you are both wonderful. Thank you.
Cheers, Mark. Thank you very much.
I hope the record player is okay after the sound effects of Total Joy. The JP Special has brightened up my week all this time. Thank you, Martin.
Cheers, Matt. Well, also, it brightens up our week. I mean, to be honest, sometimes it's like, oh, I'm sort of doing a show. That's really good. I'm really happy that I'm performing and doing something. And I mean, also, if you like this, then Total Joy is good because not only do we gab along like we normally do, but we've got some properly written features and bits and bobs and stuff that's semi-regular.
If you like the name Beep Halfords, everyone was popular with people, and then you'd like Total Joy.
Yeah, Beep Halfords now is like a Boyzone serial, which we mentioned last week. So it's Beep Halfords, Nincompoop Sleuth in 17th century space. It's like a steampunk based Boyzone adventure.
So, and I do actual acting.
Yeah, and he's really good as well. John's really good in it.
Thank you. I also do the voice of a monkey with Asperger's in another sketch. It's funny. I look forward to everything. Thank you. Oh, God, I'm just...
Thanks, Katie.
A circle joke. Has Paul ever worked with any Doctor Who lead actors?
No, never.
You ever met any?
Never. I've met some assistants. I've met Tegan Turlow. I've met Tegan Turlow, and I've also met Leela.
Wow.
Oh, and I've also met Ace as well.
I wrote Tom Baker once.
Did you?
Yeah, funnily enough, when Smersh was kind of getting a bit big.
Did you want him in?
No, well, someone said to me, someone genuinely wrote to me and said, Tom Baker is in a film called Freaks with...
I remember telling me about this,
Yeah. And I think Donald Pleasance is in it, and he said there's a Smersh connection. And he said, if you write Tom a letter, I reckon he'd do it. And he gave me Tom's address.
Oh.
And I wrote Tom a letter and never heard anything. So there's no exciting ending.
No.
But for about 2 weeks, I was like, oh, God, I'm going to chat to Tom Baker over Skype or something.
No. Can you imagine the joy that would have been?
Because I've seen Freaks and he's amazing in it. Jeffrey Palmer was the voice behind the... Yeah, we mentioned that earlier.
Yeah,
I love the chats on Total Joy as well. Thank you, Katie.
Yeah, well, John and I each week talk about two things each, that things that bring us joy or brought us joy, and it doesn't matter what they are, whether it's a film or a poem or a bit of a film or a song or a TV show or a moment in our childhood, and then it's interdispersed with bits and bobs and stuff. We just thought that might be the thing that gets us all bloody through it.
Yeah, and if you're interested, just go to on Twitter at Total Joy Podcast, and there's a link there for the Patreon. I'm afraid with the times we are in, with me having less work and Paul having not as much work as usual,
i.e. none,
it's very helpful for us if you were to give us a few quid every month. We really appreciate it.
Help me pay me rent, or my landlord makes me do special favours to him.
Yeah, or, you know, I won't go there. I've met Louise Jameson too. She's absolutely lovely. No airs or graces.
I met her in Forbidden Planet, and she was sat next to Turlo doing autographs, and it was amazing.
Furlough?
Well, I'm sure. Imagine how many times you must hear that now.
Imagine.
Yeah.
So thank you. We won't be here next week, but no. We will miss you. But we'll do something else instead. And, you know, you can always write into Macmillan and bid for this Scooby-Doo picture, what I did, which is worth about 15 pence.
Well, no. More than that, John.
I've kept all mine, but I'm not holding out hope.
You coloured that in.
I coloured that in with my children's pens.
Yeah. But, Daddy, we need the brown to finish our... Well, I'm using it for a fucking show. But, Daddy, I want the brown...
And if it wasn't imminently clear, there's no Smirch Pod this week because I'm actually giving myself a week off.
John's having a well-deserved week off because he's not just doing this. He is doing, as we say, about 15 other podcasts. And quite frankly, he wants to just lie back in his kimono. And scream.
Make a cup of hot chocolate, put on some Human League, and have a fat wank.
Oh.
No. Oh. Yeah, I'm gonna have a week of doing nothing because I've been doing...
Decadence.
I've been doing like 5 podcasts a week, and it's mental.
Yeah, and I'm sick of it. You do all the editing of them as well, so that's the thing that takes fucking ages.
Yeah. And I've done 4 this week, and each one of them, I was just like, after the end of it, I was just like, I don't want to ever hear my voice ever again. And I think that's the point where you think, I want to have a break. So I'm going to have a break, and I've cancelled everything next week, and I'm going to have a rest. And then I'll be back the week after, recharged. Lovely. Yeah. Lovely.
But don't worry, I'll still be bothering John via email and text, going, "Have you made sure you've got that ready for this? And have you written that bit yet? And I've written this. Don't forget that." So I'll still be annoying him.
Yeah. Oh no, you could never annoy me, and none of the guys in the comments could ever annoy me either.
Yeah.
Have you tried setting up an OnlyFans? No,
I don't think it's like.
I think it's where you do sexy turns for your fans, and I don't think anyone would be particularly interested. You'd be all right with your tash.
Hang on.
I mean, you did Melon Pants 1 week, which was kind of OnlyFans, so.
Yeah.
But we have run out of time, so it's just for us to say, thank you very much for watching.
Yeah. So we won't be back next week, but we'll be back the week after. Check out all the other bits and bobs available at your local stockists. And for God's sakes, stay safe.
Stay safe, stay vigilant, and be careful. And we love you, so thank you.